Good morning, all of you. Up nice and early today. But yeah, traffic as usual. Like, even if you like leave home at 7 AM, you still run into traffic in Bangalore. Cool. All right. Hope all of you had your breakfast. You're nice and awake. Okay, so let's start. I'm going to be talking about what we have been. Okay. So my name is Abhinav Rastogi. I am a lead UI engineer at Flipkart. I've been working on the Flipkart Lite, the mobile site, for the last year, and this year I've been working on the new desktop site. So I'm going to be talking about that case study of how we rebuilt Flipkart.com, the desktop site, and what the next generation of web looks like, where we are, where we are going, what are the technologies available to us, and what we can do with them. So we recently went through a facelift or a change, you know, switch from what you see on the left to what you see on the right. Most of you might have seen it. It is still being rolled out, it's rolled out for most of the users. There's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes. So what you see in a screenshot here is essentially the design overhaul that has happened. Internally, the tech stack has completely been rewritten. It's a complete overhaul rewritten from scratch. So this is what the tech stack looks like right now, where we are. We have a bunch of front-end technologies, specifically, you know, the most common stack these days on the front-end, or I think it's the most common, but yeah, we're using React, React Router, Redux, Webpack for bundling it all together on the server side, using Express and Node, Karma for our test cases, EMP to run our applications, Handlebars for our templating, and Fetch and Promises as a general browser technologies. So all this is pretty standard and well talked about now, and you know, we will be going into details, I think, throughout the day today and tomorrow, of how these technologies work, how there are alternatives to these technologies, and not necessarily how you are restricted to these. Right. So where it all began was essentially Flipkart Lite. That is where we, experimented for a lot of time, and we figured out, how to put these technologies to the best use. Namely, things like service workers, the concept of application shells, generally progressive web apps as they are defined. I'm talking about things, capabilities like being offline first, or network resilient, instant feedback, always available, things like that. So Flipkart Lite is where it all started, and we had tons of learnings from working on that. We had a lot of great conversations with a lot of folks at a lot of good companies. We spent a lot of time in researching, and what you see here is the new face of Flipkart Lite. Essentially, all the features that you see on the mobile app are loading in an instant in your browser. Again, this is being rolled out as we speak, and all of you will have access to this pretty soon. Now, the interesting part here is most companies or most websites, they have a desktop version first, and then they sort of build a mobile version for that, a light version, or a mobile version, or a responsive version. Usually it works like that. I haven't heard of a lot of cases where you develop a mobile stack first and then you migrate to a desktop. How many people have heard of that kind of situation? Cool, like 5, 6, 10 people. Not bad. All right. So what happened here is that we learned when we started working on this, there are some significant differences in how mobile works and how the desktop works. And it's not just the tech stack, it's also, the requirements are different, the user behavior is different, the form factors are different, that's the design part of it. How a user behaves, what time users log on. Interesting metrics are that, people use desktops during the day and mobiles more during evening or the night. People don't usually use desktops when they're in bed. So these kind of behavioral differences come up. Device capabilities are obviously different. Mobile phones are getting stronger every day, more powerful every day, but your desktops are still more powerful than that, especially when it comes to multi-threading and raw processing power. Browser fragmentation and distribution is very different. On mobile you have Chrome not as a majority, right? You still have UC browser, which hardly runs any good JavaScript or CSS, and it sort of dominates the market here in India. So you really have to solve for that. Network conditions, obviously one of the biggest factors for desktops. not a good assumption, but you can sort of be on the safe side that, you know, people are mostly on good, decent connections, and they won't go offline so much. Like, either they're offline or online. It's usually not that flaky unless you're on, like, a common Wi-Fi in a public place. On mobiles, however, it's vastly different. Your network connections can go off at any time. Right, so this is what a typical single page app looks like. You know, keeping all those differences in mind, this is what you can develop. And I won't go into details of all this, right? How a typical SPA works is that you serve an empty HTML from the server, the client downloads a JS bundle that's in the HTML, and you show loaders, you make API calls, you fetch the data, and you render it, right? And your subsequent navigations happen on the client. You click on a link, you already have the JS as a template, you immediately show the next screen loader, and so on and so forth. You make API calls and render. That's how SPAs have been working, and there will be further talks who go into detail of how this works. I'm here to talk about generally what happened with Flipkart. Right? We already had Flipkart Lite in place. We had the knowledge of how this works, and we were wondering what else we could do to make it better. So yeah, a typical SPA will have a lot of pros. You know, it's pretty easy to implement now. Using the technologies that I mentioned, you know, React, Angular, all of these make it pretty straightforward to implement it. Navigations are fast, it's pretty much instant once you load the first page. Server processing is very cheap. All you have to do is like serve one static HTML file, right? So one node process would serve like thousands of requests per second. And you don't even get too much traffic because only the first request for a session will come to your server. Subsequent requests will directly contact your API. So essentially it's really good. It's a good model in general. So this is what it generally looks like, right? You have your HTML, which is pretty small. You download it. Once the HTML is downloaded and parsed, CSS download starts. Your JS download starts. Your JS parses. That's when your client-side code will kick in. You make API calls. You get the data and you get your first print in a first render. Now this obviously doesn't look too good. All the way over here on the side of the screen. That's bad. Okay. So the cons here are, obviously, you have an empty page for a really long time. You have rendered nothing until that point. An interesting issue that comes up with single page apps very frequently is that, you know, your SEO gets jeopardized. The first HTML that you see here is pretty much empty. So unless a crawler can execute JavaScript, wait for you to make API calls and then re-render, the crawler won't be able to crawl all your content. And obviously the JS bundle is huge. It takes a long time. An interesting metric here is, a good one to follow is that you generally take around 1 millisecond to parse 1 KB of JavaScript. And keep in mind a gotcha here that you might be serving gzip content, so your bundle might look like 50 KB. Ungzip is going to be 500 KB, and that's the time it will take to parse it is 500 milliseconds. So apart from download, it will take half a second just to parse the JavaScript before it can execute. Keep that in mind. So now what do you do over that, right? To improve it, you come up with new methods. So what we did with Flipkart Lite was we came up with the concept of app shells, which essentially means the initial HTML that you serve from the server is not blank. It contains the loading state of your page. And obviously this needs to be context sensitive. If you request home page, you need to serve the Under which looks like a home page for a list page or a product page, it needs to look like that. So how we solved that was real-time rendering. I've talked about it earlier. It essentially means that you, at real-time, you know that there is no dynamic content in this here. So you can essentially generate this HTML at real-time. And it just becomes a static HTML that you have to serve at runtime. So it's pretty cheap. The biggest pro here, no more empty page. What you see in the first render is the loaders. So what happens now is, your first print happens the moment your HTML and CSS are ready. HTML size is not huge. It's pretty small. It's just the loaders. And your rendering is blocked on CSS downloading, which is again sequential after the HTML. So your first print comes here, which is much better than going all over here. So that's the first upgrade. Now, the con obviously here is that, you know, this is still not meaningful. This is still, it's better than an empty page, it's still just a loading state, right? The user can't really do anything about it. If he's on a slow connection, he's just staring at a loader for like 5 seconds, which is pretty bad. So that's that. So to solve that, one approach we tried was, you know, why not try server rendering? Even if you're using the modern, you know, client-side stacks, what's preventing you from running it on Node, right? You can render your full page on the server for the first request, and everything works pretty much the same. And your client will re-render the page when it has the data. So, your first page becomes meaningful. Your SEO gets solved. That's the biggest benefit. The HTML generated from the server contains all the content that you want the crawler to see. And this is what it looks like. Now, observe here, you know, you add a waiting time to your HTML because your server needs to make API calls, render the data. You have to keep the cost in mind of the rendering or templating, whatever you're doing, the API calls you're making, connection times. Then the HTML download and parsing happens, then the CSS downloads once HTML is completed, and then your first print moves here. If you see, your first print has moved again a lot to the right. And these diagrams are not to scale. I purposefully avoided adding the timelines here because I will get to that. In the future slides, I can just get squished to one side. So this is where your page becomes interactive, which is again a lot of time. So another con. So the cons here are that you get significant increase in server load. That's the biggest con, right? Rendering a page on the server using client-side technologies like you either need to use something like React DOM, you know, render to string, or you need to use PhantomJS or Rhino, you know, some way of mimicking the DOM on the server, which gets pretty costly. So there's a significant increase in server load, right? Your HTML download size increases like enormously. Loading state will be what, like 10 KB of HTML? That can fit in one HTML chunk, right? So the moment you get a response, you're done. This HTML can be like 800 KB, 1 MB of HTML, just pure HTML, depending on what page it is. It's going to keep downloading forever. Your response times have increased because again your server is processing a lot and your JS file is still huge. So it doesn't become interactive until all of this is ready. It's like too many cons, right? This approach doesn't work. So, next update. The next thing we tried was the concept of universal apps that you render only SEO critical content on the server. Client continues to work the way it was, and most modern libraries can reconcile the changes. So, what that means is that by SEO critical content, I mean things like the title of the page, the meta tags, things like that. So, at least you got some content out in the first. So what happens here is that you could render just header, footer, and meta tags from your server response and load everything else on the client. And the pros here are obviously your server load becomes much lesser. You're not making those API calls. You're not processing that much HTML on the server. Your SEO is not as good as full server rendering, but it's still better than doing nothing at all on the server. And your header and footer can load quickly. You can still show loaders in the first frame. You get a big boost in the perceived performance. And the cons obviously are that, you know, your first print is still slow. You are still trying to run client-side code on your server. You're still trying to For example, at Flipkart, we are heavily into the service-oriented architecture. So even SEO for us is a service. We give it a URL of a page and it tells us the meta tags and the page type and stuff like that. And the huge piece of text you put in the footer always, right? Like that. So yeah, that is still there. You still don't have any organic content in the first pane. You still have loaders. Like, what does the user do with that, right? And your JS file is still huge. You don't get much benefit there. So the next update would be, you know, you are anyway doing all this just for a minimal extra cost. You might as well just render the first fold. So again, getting closer to the server rendering. But bear with me here. You just render the first fold of the page. Like, you can lazy load the rest. What that looks like is essentially this, that instead of showing loaders, you show some content on the screen, you know what's going to be in the first fold for like 90% of your audience. So you can get metrics of what the browser resolutions are. Now an interesting pitfall we ran into here was, you know, the moment you render this kind of HTML, how your typical HTML looks like is you have your, you know, body tag, your div tag, which contains everything in HTML, and then you have your script tags, right? If that HTML has images in it, like IMG SRCs, those images are going to start downloading immediately. And what happens is it will not necessarily block your JavaScript resources, but it is going to contend for the network. And if those images are large, for example, you know, these banners here are pretty huge, you are going to sort of delay loading your JavaScript even further, which is bad. So an interesting thing we did here was concept of progressive images. It has been very popular for some time. Medium specifically has been doing this really well for a long time. You load much smaller images, you know, lower resolution images first, and then you replace them using JavaScript, using the high-res images once they are downloaded. And you start the download later, of course. And the browsers, interestingly, will automatically blur them. So you don't even need to do CSS blurring for most of the browsers. The difference, the benefit you get is huge. This image here could very well be 300 kilobytes. The full resolution image. The small one is hardly 300 bytes. That's the benefit you get. So you get, you put in progressive images along with this, your client side is still pretty fast. Pros are that, you know, your server is making the API calls now. There is a benefit to it. And the plus side is that making API calls from server is generally better, because now you're making API calls server to server, which is within your data center ideally. And you get rid of all the latencies of the network, you get rid of connection lookups. Your server can have an ETC host entry for your API server. You don't even need to do a DNS resolution. You get organic content in the first paint, and the best part is that you have anyway made an API call to get all this data from the server. You might as well send it to the client. Why does the client need to make that API call again, right? You can just append it to the end of your HTML, like after the script tags or something, and your script can read from that JSON itself. The client doesn't need to make up a new connection, and the server, the API server doesn't need to process it again. A big one at this point was still that, you know, your JavaScript is still huge and everything will get blocked on that. So the best part, the interesting part we worked on here was that you split your JS bundle into different chunks based on the page that you're on. Once you think about it, it's like a really no-brainer. That's how jQuery used to work. I mean, once you have jQuery, every page used to have its own JavaScript, like whatever is needed on that page. Don't load the checkout JavaScript on the home page unless it's needed. So you only load JS required for the current page, and your subsequent JavaScript resources can be loaded when needed. It's pretty obvious once you think about it. So this is what it looks like for us. This is the old one. You had one app bundle which was like 206 KB, huge chunk of JavaScript there. And once you split it based on routes like home page, product list page, offers, you know, search, product, and all, these are the sizes. So you get like, you need only 32 kilobytes of JavaScript to render the home page. Right? This looks pretty fancy, and believe me, it's pretty easy too. How do you break the JS bundle? You have to define split points in your application. Your code will have like a 200, you will have 200 components, and you are bundling them together somehow using Webpack, Browserify, or some tool like that. These tools make it easy to split the code actually. So all you have to do is you replace your import statements with require.ensure. That's pretty much it. That's really it. Import is, I will explain why. Okay, so import is statically analyzed. So when you import a file at the top of your script, like one component imports another, it becomes a hard dependency of that component, and that this component cannot render without that. Now, for example, if your parent component, which is rendering your entire page, will obviously be importing all the pages, because based on the route, it has to render all the pages. So if you import all of them become hard dependencies of just your shell, of your layout. So essentially everything gets bundled into the initial entry chunk, which is app.js. So splitting that, if you use require.ensure, it's essentially an async way of requiring files. It's literally what it means, right? It just ensures the file is there when it's required. So Webpack or whatever tool you're using, Webpack specifically will automatically download that JS file when it's needed. Right? So Webpack and React Auto work hand in hand for this really well. Try it out. I have a code sample here to show to you. Yeah, so this is what I was talking about. Your typical routes JS file looks like this. That you import your page at the top, then you define your routes that if you are on slash about, you render this page as a component. Or if you're using the JSX format, you do path is equal to this, component is equal to this. Pretty straightforward, like one lines of code. And to split it, all you have to do is this, that instead of just doing component, you do get component and then require.ensure of that page, of that file, and you call back with that component. When Webpack sees this require.ensure, it will not bundle this file until this route is executed. So when the browser tries to execute this route, that's when it will download this file. And if this looks too ugly, there is a loader for this for Webpack. Like there used to be, you know, there's an app for that, there's a loader for that. Pretty much everything you can get, a Webpack loader or a Babel loader. It's called the bundle loader. So you do an async require of that, and this essentially, this syntax looks pretty much exactly the same as this one. Instead of this component page, it becomes get component async require. So this is what you get in the timeline after that. You are waiting for the API calls and stuff to happen on the server. Your HTML downloads, your CSS downloads. And the moment the first chunk is ready, alright, so you get a full render at this point. Content. Now if you look carefully, this JS is much smaller. It's pretty much the same size or smaller than your CSS because you're not splitting that CSS. And you get your first render here. Now this is not to scale because the JavaScript earlier was going all the way till here. And your first render was like somewhere there off the screen. Now it has moved here. So that's the benefit you get here. And all your JS is downloading in parallel while that's happening. So why it's downloading like that is because this is what your typical HTML looks like. You have your style sheet at the top, you get your server rendered HTML here, and you have a bunch of JavaScript files here. Right? And earlier it was just render.js and app.js. By the way, I hope everyone is splitting their code into like render and app. For long term caching, the app doesn't need to be rebuilt every time, you just serve it once and it can be cached in the user's browser, so you don't have to download the React or Angular again and again. Your application code can be separate. So, there are some interesting gotchas with this approach. You need to have caching for cache testing. Like I said, if you're serving your vendor in your app.js, right? Suppose you do a code deployment tomorrow, you need to be able to tell the users or their browsers that you need to download the new file. So to do that, you need hashing. So you add hashes to your file name. So you take the content hash of the file and you append it to the file name. So if your file changes, your hash changes, file URL changes, the browser requests the new one automatically. And you can essentially indefinitely cache all of those files. Now, what happens is, I am talking specifically about Webpack here because that's what we are using. When you split your JS bundle into smaller chunks, Webpack needs to know that if I hit slash about, from the example, I need to load page.js. Right? And it needs to know page.js is in which bundle, what's the file name, what's the hash. So Webpack adds a lookup table to your entry chunk. Because entry chunk is guaranteed to be there, that's the first chunk that's loaded for any page. Typically that's like all your common modules are there and your this lookup table is there. Now what happens is if you make one change on product page, right, your hash changes, what it causes to happen is that your lookup table changes, which means your entry chunk changes, which has all your common changes which have not changed. Okay. Following me here so far? Okay. So what happens here is that your entry chunk changes, essentially you end up invalidating all your cache, right, and you lose long-term cache. You need to take care of this. Webpack allows you to add a manifest plugin here, which essentially pulls out the lookup table into a separate file. It's like a small 100 bytes, 200 bytes of a file. So only that file changes if any file changes. So we actually turn the gotcha here into a big pro for us, right, into a big benefit. That now what happens is all your bundles are separate, chunks are separate. If you change a piece of code on, say, the product page or checkout page, right, only those JS files need to be downloaded for the client. If the client doesn't go to the order summary page, right, he doesn't download any new JS. No other JS has changed. Everything renders pretty much from cache, which is moving fast. So we have converted an issue here into a growth. But this is still not fast enough, right? There is a lot more you can do. So ERPL is what we tried next. That's a pattern that has been popularized recently by Google for their Polymer apps, but it's a pattern in general. So you can apply it to any technology as such. What ERPL stands for, it's an acronym. It stands for this ERPL, that you push your critical resources for the initial route. Keyword here being push. Then you render the initial route, which is what we are doing already with chunking. You pre-cache the remaining routes. And then you lazy load and create the remaining routes on demand. Essentially, when you load homepage, you only download homepage JavaScript. Then while homepage is downloading, a server can push more content. So if you are using HTTP2 here, you can easily do this. HTTP2 supports push. Well and good. If you're not using HTTP2, I will get to that. Alright. So you render an initial route and then you can lazy load other pages JavaScript as needed. So this is what preloading looks like, right? So all your scripts at the end, it still stays there, and you essentially add link rel preloads to your head. Now, how many people are aware of this kind of thing, that there's a link rel preload? Okay, a few. All right, interesting. So I'm sure there are other talks which will go deeper into this. I will do a quick update on this. So link rel preload essentially tells the browser to download these files in parallel to the HTML without blocking, but not to evaluate or execute that file. So these files will download in this order along with the CSS, but won't execute until the script tag comes in, and they will execute in this order. You can download in a different order and execute in a different order. It's really cool. I will show you how. Okay. So along with that, since you don't, if you don't have HTTP2, which is the case with us due to some infrastructural challenges. We are still on HTTP 1.1 as of now. So one way to mimic the push of content is essentially, what does push mean, right? That you don't block your resources downloading on your HTML downloading. You can do that with HTTP 1.1. All you need to do is convert your HTML response to the transfer chunk encoding. What that means is that, since some parts of your HTML are independent of your page content, for example, your header, footer, your meta tags, things like that, your CSS, your JavaScript bundles, are independent of which page you are on. You can push them out as soon as you get a request. You don't need to figure out what API do I need, what data do I need to render that page, right? And then you send those first for the resource download to start, and then you do a smart use of preload, prefetch, and defer. So preload is what I showed you. Prefetch and defer are other options that you have, which function a little differently. Again, there will be other talks detailing on this. So this is how we do streaming using Express, right? In your route handler, you set your content type explicitly. If you do response.render, it automatically sets it. Response.set you need to do. Then you write your HTML head tag up to the opening body tag, which has all your link preloads and your style tags. You write it and you flush it to the user. At this point, the HTML stream has opened, and this is like, as soon as you get the request, this is all static. This is milliseconds after you've responded with the head part of your HTML, milliseconds after getting the request. Right? Then you do your whole server rendering. This could be templating, this could be Angular, this could be React, whatever. And you write that, and then you write your script tags, and you close your response. Right? This is what some very basic streaming looks like. And this is what it looks like for the client on the timeline. Your HTML is, so this maps to the same blue chunk that was there on just the left side, zoomed in. Right? So this HTML is still taking, let's say, what, 500 milliseconds to download. Now your CSS can start downloading at like 50 milliseconds after getting the request. How cool is that? Right? And all of these things don't block the HTML. If you do a preload, nothing is blocking your HTML from rendering or parsing. HTML continues to work the way it was, but now you're downloading these resources in parallel. What happens is that HTML is downloading in this part and it's parsing for a lot of time. If you look carefully at the timeline, you're going to see this happening in parallel. So it starts in milliseconds. The first print happens here as soon as the HTML, some part of the HTML is ready. And your full page render happens once your HTML is complete. That's when you get the last script tag and it has executed. So this JavaScript will execute here once you see the script tag. And you can load your JS chunks which are not needed on that page later after it doesn't block the interaction with the page. So obviously the pros here are that your CSS and JS resources can start downloading immediately. It's all happening in parallel, so you can make use of this feature of the browser. Your page is ready to render as soon as HTML is ready, which is pretty fast. Right? The con here obviously is that now your server needs to keep a connection open with the client. So, you know, I figured this out after I implemented this, that what happens is, suppose your Express is fronted by Nginx, right, a reverse proxy. Even if you're streaming content, Express is generating a stream, Nginx will buffer that stream. And once Express closes that stream, Nginx will send the entire HTML together to the client. Why? Like, you lose all the chunking, you lose all the streaming benefits, right? Nginx does that for a reason. The reason is that your Express server becomes immune to client latencies. So if a client is really slow, he's on a 56 kbps modem, right, from the old ages. He's going to take like 5 minutes just to download your HTML. It's, like I said, it's a 500 kb HTML. At 50 kbps, it's easily going to take 10 seconds. So now what will happen is, your Express server will need to keep a connection open with the client if Nginx is not buffering. And Express, being running in JavaScript in Node, it's single-threaded. It can only do one request at a time. So unless you close that response, it cannot take a new request. So for 10 seconds, your Express server is blocked from taking any other requests. Right. So that's the benefit and the issue with buffering in Nginx. And it's very easy to turn it off. You just have to give one statement in your Nginx config, proxy buffering off. It will turn it off. And another con on the inside here is that your client can download only a limited number of resources at a time. So don't make everything parallel. So this is what it looks like in real life. This is a screenshot from the production Flipkart site. This is what I was talking about earlier. This is the blue part for the HTML and everything else happens after HTML is complete. So this is your first paint at around 2.5 seconds. And this is your complete render, DOM complete at 3.5 seconds. If you stream it, essentially what happens is these blue chunks you see here are downloading HTML and the light blue is parsing. This is by the way Chrome DevTools on Chrome Canary with the network enabled in timeline. So you can see how your network requests are happening. Now your CSS is downloading, JS is downloading in parallel, JS is split into chunks, and your first paint is at 1000 milliseconds. Your first paint with meaningful content is at 1 second, which is the benchmark we had set for ourselves. And your DOM complete also happens faster because now everything is happening parallel to this. Essentially, you move the whole chunk here to the left with this one small trick. An interesting thing here is your first paint event by the browser is here, but what is this duration like? How did these images started downloading without preload if HTML was not there? So the interesting thing we noticed is that visually, if you see, so you can also capture screenshots in this. Visually, your first paint actually happens here, but the browser tracks it here. This is what we figured, right? So what this led us to believe was that, you know, browser waits for certain steps to certain conditions for it to be considered as painted, but for the user what matters is visually, is it there or not. So you know, if you're working on this kind of the cutting edge of you know, optimizing using all these technologies, PR, PL and all, you can't really depend on things like DOM content loaded and the window onload event to track your performance. You have to start tracking custom metrics, and you can use things like the request animation frame and user timing API to track such things. For example, you have this performance.mark as part of the standard now. It's a window.performance.mark. It essentially marks this as a point in the timeline. Now the beautiful part about this is that this is a standardized API, which means websites like web page test understand this point. Just by the virtue of doing this, webpagetest.org, SpeedCurve, DareBoost, all these technologies which track, which do synthetic testing, just by putting this line in your code as the first thing in your before your HTML, these tools will mark this point on the timelines on their websites. You don't have to do nothing, anything about it at all. This is all. And you get these custom metrics. You could do performance.measure to track how much time was spent in the API calls, how much time was spent in rendering, things like that. So these are things you should track, right? You should track all these custom metrics, which is very important. Cool. So the key takeaways here are that you have to solution differently for mobile and desktop. You have to treat performance as a feature. That's what we do. It's not just a side effect or a byproduct of what you're building. Biggest thing, you can't optimize what you can't measure. You have to measure it again and again and again in every single thing. You can split JS bundles into smaller chunks. You can preload those chunks smartly, but don't block your main thread on that. And real user monitoring is important. Synthetic testing doesn't always work as you expect. Cool, so that's all. Thank you. Do we have time for Q&A? So that's my Twitter. The slides are available at this URL if you want to take a look.
Yeah, just something real quick.
Sure.
In all the measurements and other graphs you showed, what were, did you throttle your dev tool speed to a certain?
Yeah, so the graph that I showed here, the real graph, is actually throttled at 3G.
And so when you did all these measurements and all these optimizations, how does the latency of the network figure into this?
Mm-hmm.
Are you only relying on the speed of the network to figure out what to preload, when to preload, how to do something, or are you also taking latency into account?
Definitely. So like I said, by virtue of making API calls on the server, you get rid of a lot of latencies that you're going to run into. Another bunch of latencies are just setting up these connections, right, with your CDN or with your server. So for that, there are other tags, like you can do DNS prefetching, or you can do a pre-connect. Like I talked about link rel is equal to preload, there is also rel is equal to pre-connect, which will essentially set up the HTTP connection for that resource, but download it when it's actually requested, right? So we are doing all that, and that removes all the latencies from these requests. But yes, those are considered. And when you throttle in Chrome, it also adds a latency to the connection, apart from lowering the speed.
What was the major gotchas when you started working on Cooperlite to choose a React over other JS?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
To choose a React over other JS. What were the major goals you wanted to achieve that time?
Okay. All right, so how we approached choosing React, okay, so we took this decision like really long back, almost 1.5-2 years back of building all this on React. That's before we started work on Flipkart Lite. The reason we chose React was, I will tell you the procedure we went through. So we started building our own rendering library, right? And we built the entire component system, we built the dependency system and all that stuff. And that's when we realized that React is the one which suits our needs the best, right? That is what our library was looking like. And React being maintained by Facebook has a ton of other features that we could not have built or maintained, right? On just with a small team. So that is the approach we usually take, that, you know, we figure out what we need to build, what we need, because only when you try to build it yourself will you be able to tell what are exact requirements, right? Like things like Angular has things like factories and services and all, which are really good for some use cases, not for us, right? So I'm not saying build everything in-house, right? Use ready-made tools where applicable, but yes, you need to understand your requirements very clearly. Specifically for us, if you look at React versus Angular, if that's what you talk about, React is more of just a rendering engine. It's just the view layer. Angular has a lot of other stuff. It's the entire MVVM architecture. We wanted more flexibility. We didn't need double binding. We needed single binding. A lot of such things. And combined with Redux and all, we could build a very customized architecture of how we make API calls and how we fetch data, how we cache it. So that's how we took the decision. fill it. No, so the only request going to the node server here is this HTML. All of these are going to the CDN. They're all different URLs, right? CDNs are meant to take this kind of a load. CDNs are built, they have a lot of caching, they have a lot of resilience to these kind of, you know, multiple requests from the same client. We also use, like, we keep the connections open. So if you make one request, the connection remains open for a few seconds, so you don't have to set it up again. So you can optimize that. Yes, definitely. So if you split your resources into these multiple chunks, right? So instead of making 5 requests, now you're making 10 requests, right? So of course, your server will suffer if you make too many requests, especially if you're using Express and Node, right? Like I said, it's single-threaded. CDNs, on the other hand, are built to take like millions of requests per second. So they can handle this load quite easily.
To enhance the performance of this SPA, have you considered the approach of multi-app architecture?
Sorry?
Multi-app architecture.
Multi-app architecture.
Multi-app.
I'm not sure I get that. I'm not aware of it.
I'm just asking to increase the performance of single page application. Have you considered the multi-app architecture approach?
I'm not aware of the multi-app architecture. Let's discuss outside and explain what it is. We can probably discuss more on it. Mm-hmm. Any more questions?
Hello?
Yeah.
Where Hello?
Are you? Okay.
Here. Yeah. So, great insights. So, you mentioned for server-side rendering, you are using React DOM, render to string, right?
Yeah.
So that's a synchronous call, right?
That is a?
Synchronous call.
Yes, it is.
So how you scale the number of requests per seconds?
Right, okay, good question. So yes, server rendering with React DOM has a significant cost. The reason why I said full page rendering on server is costly is because React DOM, experimentally, these are not published numbers, but experimentally we have seen like an exponential increase when you increase the DOM size. So we sort of found the sweet spot where it does not like take a whole second to render, but it finishes in within a few milliseconds, but we are still able to render some content. You cannot work around the blocking model of that. React DOM will block the thread. You could spawn up a worker, give your DOM to that to render and then get it back. But there's still a significant overhead in just, you know, threaded communication. So yes, that is a cost we are living with. That is where you actually scale horizontally. You add more machines if you can't render those many strings together.
Okay. So we have like built a small library kind of thing, which is like a caching on top of React rendering.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, if your component is a pure render component,
mm-hmm.
then based on the props, you can just cache it.
Right.
Markup.
Yeah, definitely. So React, there are a bunch of libraries for React also, or for Webpack, which will allow you to cache pure components quite easily. And an interesting insight we learned there actually was that in React, you can define classless functions, right, as pure functions. Those are actually not cached by React. Actually, what is better is that if you define, you'd use react.create class, or you use a class like extends component, mm-hmm. and you do a should component update false if it's a pure function, right? Obviously with a shallow compare. That is actually much faster. React doesn't, doesn't memoize pure functions. So that's actually something that we looked into and that gives a lot of benefit.
Okay. Yes. In this, you have a question, right? Lots of questions for Abhinav and be taken outside. Thanks a lot, Abhinav. I think this is a great start of the conference.
Thank you.